Historically, giant ragweed was found mostly in undisturbed areas, such as fence rows and drainage ditches, and occasionally on floodplain fields. However, in the past two decades, giant ragweed populations have dispersed into many fertile fields across the Corn Belt. In most of the Midwest, giant ragweed seedlings emerge in late March. They can be identified by their large, spoon-shaped cotyledons, which range from 3/8 to 5/8 inches wide and 1 to 1 3/4 inches long. The first true leaves have deep lobes, but later leaves have lobes characteristic of giant ragweed. Giant ragweed leaves generally have 3 distinct lobes, but can have as many as 5. Although mature giant ragweed can grow to 17 feet tall, its height often depends on competition with other plants. In a field setting, giant ragweed is often 1 to 5 feet taller than the crop with which it is competing. The early emergence and rapid growth rate of giant ragweed provides it an initial advantage over many other weeds and crops. By emerging before other weeds or crops, giant ragweed exploits the available nutrients, water, and light before the crop. As a result, this species typically dominates the community in which it's growing by existing in pure stands. Kevin Bradley studies herbicide resistance in this northeastern Missouri soybean field that has become infested with glyphosate-resistant giant ragweed.
This is what a lot of growers will do. They will choose to put a tank mix in with their glyphosate even after the soybeans have emerged and we haven't controlled the giant ragweed with the burn down, or maybe we got additional flushes. And so what we're doing in this trial, you might see some little ribbons down in here, and that's actually where we're tracking the survival of the population. All of these plants with a orange ribbon around them, they were treated with a labeled glyphosate rate plus a tank mix partner in soybeans. In this case, it was Famisafen or Flexstar is one of the trade names of that particular chemical. If you're going to take that approach, we want you to do it when they're very small. And again, this is a glyphosate resistant population. Bottom line is we would much rather see a pre-plant burn down treatment on giant ragweed that is effective, something with residual control and that also controls what's there at the time of application, and then come back with a tank mix in crop if possible.
Herbicide-resistant weeds are currently impacting agriculture on an unprecedented scale. Each year, herbicide-resistant weed populations occur with increasing frequency in response to the selection pressure imposed on them by modern crop production techniques. In order to prevent this situation from degrading further, producers must have a change in their mindset of weed management. For the most part, weed management decisions are currently based on single-year economic thresholds. However, in order to stop the spread and progression of herbicide-resistant weed populations, producers must think longer term and diversify their weed management techniques. This includes considering all available chemical, cultural, mechanical weed control methods, with the ultimate goal of eliminating weed seeds from the soil seed bank. Because many current herbicides have the same mechanisms of action, producers must understand herbicide mechanism of action and frequently rotate to herbicides that have different mechanisms of action so that resistant weeds do not predominate our production systems. Ultimately, the focus must shift from a single to a multifaceted approach. This way, producers can not only improve their weed management, but they can also be an effective part of the effort to prevent the further spread of herbicide-resistant weeds.